Hi folks, this is David Kwan. Now I know this was Thanksgiving week, for many of you guys out there, especially in the United States. And yeah, I know you guys had a lot of great festivities, a lot of things to celebrate, but there was actually a really serious news that happened this week, and it's not so happy. And so either whatever your views are, this was the serious thing that was talked about this week with the grand jury decision to whether or not to indict police officer Darren Wilson, and the grand jury decided not to indict him. So that was a big thing, and I see on my Facebook feed that it's being talked about a lot, and I think that's a good thing, you know, that it's a topic that's getting talked about a lot. Of course, I can't judge by my Facebook feed whether that's happening, that this conversation is happening a lot or not, because of the algorithms of Facebook. Facebook shows me what it thinks that I would be interested in reading or watching about. A better gauge would be if I was more actively looking at my Twitter feed and whatnot. Maybe that would be a better way to gauge how active this discussion is, or you know, how large this discussion is. But anyway, I think it's really important that there is discussion and conversation happening about this topic, and for people to able to communicate more and converse more honestly about what's going on in Fergueson, or what has been going on in Fergueson and cities like it and around the country, you know. And it's interesting, the kind of two sides to the debate, you know. Well, many sides, actually. I guess I tend to focus on the two noticeable mindset. One is the mindset that's like, oh, we need to wait, you know, we need to look at all the evidence first. So it's very focused on this one case of Michael Brown being ended up shot dead by the actions of police officer Darren Wilson. And of course, people are going to say, oh, what about personal responsibility of Michael Brown? And he was like, you know, he was threatening the officer, and it was like, well, whatever. So this mindset is solely focused on this one case. And so, like, there's this attitude, like, you know, not if Darren Wilson was proven innocent, like, it still wouldn't matter to the community there. You know, they're still going to have protests and riots and whatnot. So this is liberal hypocrisy at its best. So that's one mindset, you know, so focused on this one case. Which is interesting, because ironically, the other mindset, the liberal hypocrisy mindset, is super broad, right? Maybe it's too broad, but it's this bent up frustration that they had over decades, over centuries, about mistreatment, about poverty, about police brutality. It's not even, it's beyond Michael Brown versus Darren Wilson case. That's just one example. You know, so the people who are protesting out there, they're not so madly focused on whether, you know, Darren Wilson got the indictment or not. That was like one of the tipping points, or one of the added layers, like, oh, this happened. But it's just added on and on and on years of you know, reports of or incidents where police shot unarmed, you know, teenagers or unarmed people, or kids with BB guns. So it's now tied to this case in New York City. I forget the name, but a 12-year-old kid was shot dead holding a BB gun. But there's all these like interwoven connected piece to it, that Darren Wilson, whatever, is just one event out of thousands, and going on for years and years and years. So there's the two mindsets there. One is specifically focused on the events of this case. And that's like, oh, we need to look at this case, what happened, and we need to react coolly and logically regarding this incident. This other one is just like, the system is fucked up. And so this is just yet another example of how our system is corrupt, blah, blah, blah. So those are the two mindsets that's kind of having, you know, a lot of conversation is rising up. I think there are two different kinds of conversations. But when you have all these kind of conversations on the interwebs, mixing and interweaving and debating and arguments, it all gets put into the same conversation, which I don't think that's a problem. But I think it's a problem when we don't recognize that. when we don't recognize that there are kind of many different kinds of conversation happening around this one topic. I'm of the camp that doesn't really see this as one incident of Michael Brown. You know, I mean, it could be argued that Darren Wilson was innocent. You know, he didn't have his actions were not examples of excessive police authority. Okay, you know, that could be proven, and my response would still be, so what? That's great. I mean, that's great that he's innocent, but what about these thousands of other cases of police brutality or people, the phenomenon of suicide by cop phenomenon that's been happening for over a decade now, and the issue of poverty and racism in cities like Fergueson. Like, those are serious issues that's been continuing on for years and years and years. And, you know, there's also the two mindsets. I think people of either mindset have been actually posting a lot of memes that have Martin Luther King Jr. in it, which I find is so interesting that the two sides would use kind of the same images, but the messages are completely different. So the mindset about, you know, that's specifically focused on, you know, being cool and collected about the Fergueson case, it would have a meme like this. It would have two pictures. One is Martin Luther King Jr. walking in solidarity with his black and white brothers, fighting against and protesting peacefully. You know, they're and wearing suits. You know, they're dressed really nicely. And then the picture below that would be like just this mob of this collection of many black people wearing like white beater shirts, you know, jeans that are dragged out. So the stereotypical image of like black gangsters, you know, whether they are not or whether they are or not, you know, you can't judge by a picture, but that's kind of the message it sends. And it's like the meme is like Martin Luther King Jr. Would not have supported this. You know, it was like, or remember when protests looked like this, and that's the picture of Martin Luther King Jr., but now we're having this, you know, and that's like this massive group of black people looking ghetto-ish, you know, and kind of crowding over broken cars and stores with glasses broken open, you know, stuff like that. That's one meme that's coming from that mindset. And the other meme that kind of comes up a lot now, from the other mindset, is Martin Luther King Jr.'s quote about the best solution against protest is social justice and kind of making sure that people are, I can't remember the exact quote, but they use that quote a lot with the image of Martin Luther King Jr. saying, social justice, addressing the issues of poverty, addressing the issues of police brutality, these are the best solutions to preventing protests. That's something that Martin Luther King Jr. said, and that's being used a lot in this other mindset of, let's look at the broader picture and not just Fergueson. So I think that's really interesting. You know, just the whole, let's go back, going back to the specifics of this grand jury, non-indictment, I guess that's the result. It's really, I don't know, you know, I'm not very knowledgeable about legal matters, but to my knowledge, what it was supposed to be, what it is basically, does Darren Wilson, should he be tried or not? I think that was the general question. Should he be tried or not? It wasn't whether is Darren Wilson innocent. We don't test for innocence on the court of law. My bad. Is he guilty or not guilty? I don't think that was the question that was being addressed in this to the grand jury. It wasn't a question of is he guilty or not guilty. That's what a trial decides. But this wasn't a trial. This was to decide, should he be tried or not? And I think that's why many left-leaning or anti-racist community organizers and activists and people like that, that's why they're so upset. Because there were like many kind of statements that were contradictory from eyewitness, from so it seems like a probable cause could be easily determined by us onlookers, you know. And grand juries are not really, they don't really, are not supposed to get, this is my understanding, any special evidence, you know, that's like privileged evidence. Like, you know, for this grand jury, they got testimony from Darren Wilson himself for like an hour or something like that, which I've been reading is pretty unusual for a grand jury indictment. Usually that doesn't happen. That's for a trial. This was treated like a trial. I feel like the grand jury was deciding whether he's guilty or not, when they should actually have been deciding should he be tried or not. This wasn't a question of guilt. This was a question of, does he have probable cause of excessive use of police authority? And if so, he should be tried. Most grand juries get, you know, give indictments. I think because it's such a low bar. Should you try a person or not? Like, in most cases, that's a yes. If it's a suspect and there is probable cause involved. So, I don't know. This whole that's why kind of it's so weird to me that the grand jury would decide not to indict him. The legal stuff kind of flies over my head because I don't really know too much on the legal matters. But that's also what's been kind of frustrating at the same time. But this is a case that has the national attention, which I think is very interesting because it has people asking, like, why Fergueson? You know, what about the other many other stuff that's like, why hasn't our attention focused on that? And either way, you know, people bring that question up, whatever their views may be. If they think Darren Wilson is innocent, they still bring up, why this case? What about the cases where a white kid was shot by a black officer? That question comes up, you know, and on the other side of the camp, it's like, why Fergueson when something like this happened already 10 years ago, or 5 years ago, a month ago, yesterday? You know, why Fergueson? Is also a question that gets addressed a lot. And I don't know if there's any solid answer to that. All I can say is I'm really intrigued by the conversations that's been happening around this. And that's important, I think, to have conversations, to realize that what's been going on is not... For me, I'm in the camp, let's look at the broader picture kind of camp. This is a broader issue than just this one incident. It is an extremely tragic incident that happened. Somebody died. A kid died. You know, a teenager died for whatever reason. And I don't think that was... that is unfortunate. You know, the camp that, like, first, like, kind of upsets me the most... is a camp that's this, or not the camp, sorry, it's wrong to say camp, but the thought, this idea that Michael Brown deserved to die is disturbing because there's hardly any crimes in this country that would warrant the death penalty. You know, hardly any crime. Even rape doesn't get the death penalty in almost all states. There are many states with the death penalty, but most of it is for, like, first-degree murder. Stealing from a store? Sorry, that's not death penalty. That's you know, maybe you, in the worst case, you might spend a lot of years in jail, in prison, whatnot. But, you know, threatening or harassing or attacking a police officer, still, like, you know, in some states you get 7 years in jail or whatever. Yeah, you know, but people who say that Michael Brown deserved to die, or this thought, this idea that, oh, he was a thug, or he was a thief, whatever, it doesn't, I think that's irrelevant to justifying the death of Michael Brown. I think that's where, for me, the view is way too extreme. I guess the sensible view for a view I don't really agree with, but I think is sensible to have, is that Darren Wilson didn't exercise excessive use of force in this incident. I think that is a possibly sensible view. Of course, we can't really make that assertion without knowing exactly the details of the evidence and what happened and whatnot. You know, what we're saying at this point is just we're just armchair critics, you know, most of us. But I think even if I don't agree with that view, I think that is a sensible view. What I think is an extremely offensive view is the view that's like that. You know, that's like Michael Brown. So what if Michael Brown was shot to death? Like, he was a thug who was big, he was threatening the police officer, and before he got arrested, he just stole, like, candy and snacks at a store. So, you know, that's whatever. That view, I think, is highly disturbing, extremely offensive, and I would say racist. Because it's like, you know, it boggles my mind that could be an acceptable idea. I think that's where you kind of is for me, that's extreme. On the other hand, on the other extreme, you know, is where now there's this politicizing of this incident. And all parties are guilty of this. Just me by talking about this incident, I guess I'm guilty of politicizing this event too. But I think that's fine. We all talk about events with our own agenda in mind. You know, you just need to be more transparent, and the conversations need to be more of a dialogue when that happens. But yeah, I guess now, you know, protests have. There's now been a reignition of a protest movement going on. You know what? What makes me wonder though, if Darren Wilson did get indicted, and he was tried, and in the trial, he was the ultimate verdict was that he was not guilty, and that's a likely scenario. You know, grand jury indicting him, that's not a big deal. That's just saying he deserves a trial. And let's say he gets a trial. I would say if Darren Wilson did get a trial, most likely, like, I would say, in my opinion, 95% chance that he would have gotten the not guilty verdict. I'm pretty certain that's what would have happened. Now, if that's what happens, then would the protests be extremely more worse than what's happening right now? I would think so. So maybe the grand jury was thinking ahead of the future. Maybe not. I don't know. But this is just kind of my creative thinking. It's like, maybe they were like, oh, you know, if we indict him and he gets the not guilty verdict, then the whole nation would be thrown in an uproar, like how LA riots kind of threw the nation in an uproar. And we don't want that, do we? Maybe that was kind of the thinking that was going on. I don't know. In which case, that would have been politicizing, you know? I mean, but for the reason to prevent a protest or prevent a riot, or prevent, you know, whatever. But yeah, I think for me personally, I think a riot is more, I feel more upset by him not being indicted than him being, getting a not guilty verdict, because we're not even trying him. We're saying this guy doesn't deserve a trial, for me, that's personally frustrating, and I can't really wrap my mind around how this could have happened if, you know, this grand jury got more evidence than a typical grand jury gets. They got a testimony from the defendant, they got picture evidence, they got all this kind of evidence, and for me, when I get that, I would be like, that would lead me to more to the decision of trying this person instead of not indicting him. I don't understand how or why, but I think it is a bigger picture. I think that it's a systemic issue. And so there are many kind of outlets that's been kind of making their statements. You know, my school, NYU, made a statement. There's this group of anti-racism group in New York City that's allied or that's for promoting change in all New York City social work schools. That's made a statement. The National Association of Social Workers made a statement. Some corporations made statements that were made open to the public. A lot of nonprofits made statements. So it's really interesting, kind of the messaging that gets sent out in these public statements. A lot of it is based around the issue of police brutality. You know, excessive use of police. So the solution is kind of there's a lot of resolution surrounding. You know, there should be police should wear cameras, required to wear cameras. And there should be reports made of how many police officers kill, you know, how many people are killed by police officers, because that kind of stat is not there. It doesn't exist. No one knows, you know. And so that's kind of the view, the lens. And it's interesting because, you know, if as a social work student, my focus would not necessarily be on police brutality, whatever, but on social justice, on poverty, on homelessness, on workers' rights, you know, I think those are very strongly tied. And also the issue of racism. You can't talk about Fergueson, I think, without racism. And I think in general, you can't talk really about American social justice and how it works without talking about not only about poverty and class, but about racism as well. So that's why I'm really glad that this kind of conversation is happening, hopefully to help us more be aware of these kind of things. But it is a very interesting thing that's been kind of been blowing up right around this time. And yeah, I think I've out-talked myself now. This video is really long, so I'm going to end it here. But yeah, tell me guys, you guys tell me what you think about this. Keep it civil, keep it polite and respectful. Yeah, and hope you guys, whatever. Cheers.